Hi everyone, my name is Todor Mitev, and in this short lecture I want to talk to you about the concepts of framing and schema. These concepts are fundamental parts of how we perceive reality, and they're used to describe the mechanics of perception. And this is really important to understand if you're working in media and if you want to understand the process in which audiences perceive reality through their interactions with content. So I will start by talking a little bit about perception, then I'll jump into schema, and finally I'll talk about framing as a concept. All right, so let's focus on the process of perception itself. In this little graph that you're seeing on your screen, I've described how perception actually works in practice, and it always starts from the chaotic ocean of stimuli hitting our sensory apparatus. This is that stage of the event, right? And I'll focus on each of these stages in turn in a little bit more detail. And then perception moves to the second stage, the stage of the frame, in which we make sense of the perceived. We make sense of that stimuli which has been detected by our perception window. And finally, it is in that sense-making window, in the sense of the in the window of the frame, that we are able to generate stories about the world. We are able to generate narratives about the world. We are able to generate models of reality. So this is the final stage, the story stage, which allows us to build a coherent picture of reality and our environment. So this this is a process. This is not a one-off teleological event. This is a process, and it's a cyclical, it's an ongoing process through which we are basically performing ourselves into existence, as it were, from moment to moment. And the key thing to understand here is that at the originary stage, at the stage of the event, this is a chaotic situation because our senses are bombarded continuously by a plethora of all sorts of different stimuli. Then we have an internal process which is happening in our mind. The process this is the second stage, the stage of the frame, and then finally we have the stage at which we are able to generate a coherent picture of reality and perhaps act on it. All right, so now let's look at them in detail. At the stage of the event, this is the stage at which we perceive reality, and the key thing to understand here is that reality always emits on all frequencies, as it were. Any possible sensory frequency that could be imagined is a frequency on which reality emits. That this is a frequency in which something is happening, on which there is some sort of information event, as it were. However, our perception window is extremely narrow. It's minuscule as compared to the infinity of frequencies on which reality emits. And this specific narrow perception window is the window defined by the parameters of our senses through which we actually are able to perceive the external stimuli hitting our perception window. And the thing is that this kind of stimuli can be real or they can be imagined, and we'll talk more about this down the track. The key thing to remember though is that this perception window is very narrow, it's very small, and it is our only way to detect external happenings, external events. Finally, the interesting thing about this is that from the perspective of the mind, everything hitting our narrow perception window and being registered as an event is actually an informational event, right? The mind perceives reality as information, right? So no matter what is being perceived, this is always already an informational event for the mind. All right, so we've perceived something. Our sensory apparatus has processed some sort of information event, and then this information passes through what we call our perception frame, or in other words, our sense-making window. So this is the stage at which we are starting to build some sort of coherency about this information that has hit our perception window, right? So this is the stage at which we are making sense of the perceived reality, and at which we're starting to model the external reality as something outside, as something with a meaning, right? Because only if and when we have that model, we can continue to the third stage, which is the story stage, where we have a coherent narrative. The key thing to understand here, and this is the reason why I'm making this lecture, is that it is at the frame stage where one can find the main pathway for exploits. As I'm borrowing here a term from the internet and from hacker culture, and also exploit is something that can be identified as a weakness in a system. So the frame stage and the process of framing and information flow is the main exploit pathway for all sorts of phenomena such as propaganda and public relations and advertising and all sorts of other aspects of perception manipulation, right? Because it is at this stage where perception itself is being formed. And after that sense-making, meaning-making process has reached a certain stage, we're reaching this part of the process where we are forming a coherent narrative about reality, right? So we're moving to the story level, where we're not making sense of what we're perceiving, but we're already having some sort of coherency about the picture. We've already fitted whatever we've perceived and made sense of into a coherent story about the world, about reality. And the key thing about the story level is that this is the level at which we have, as it were, actionable model of what is happening out there. So these stories here can be understood as patterns. They are quite long, actually. Patterns of action in reality. They give us models of reality and blueprints for action. So we have a movement, continuous movement, from the external chaos to the internal coherence about the external chaos, right? From the external event through the frame to the story, which is always already internally coherent. It presents some sort of model, right? So the model itself might be chaotic, not entirely making sense internally to us. We could be asking ourselves, why is reality not making sense? But in the macro picture, the model, the story model that we generate about reality is always coherent. So we have a movement from chaos to coherence, from the event through the frame to the story. The focus of this lecture is on this stage, on the frame stage, on the sense-making window as the main exploit pathway. All right, so we already established that the process of framing and frames themselves, and we will unpack what frames mean in great detail, format this chaotic and complex flow of information stimuli coming from the external reality into some sort of discernible narrative about an external event. So to perceive that external event and to make sense of it, we need to generate a story about it, right? And it's through framing that we're able to do that. It's through framing that we're able to position the different stimuli into some sort of coherent picture about which we can tell a story. So this process looks more or less like this. And this might look quite confusing, but actually it's really not. So we have chaotic stimuli hitting us hitting our perception window, and they're hitting on all possible frequencies. Our perception window can capture only so much of those stimuli, and as they pass through our perception window, they automatically arrive, you could imagine it that way, in our sense-making window, where we they're hitting our frames of perception, or rather our frame of perception, to simplify this further. And this is the sense-making window, because it's only through, only at this stage, that we're able to understand and create some sort of meaning about those chaotic stimuli. And after we've been able to understand, to map the chaotic stimuli to some sort of sense-making internal frame, we are able to build a coherent story about that event that we've just perceived, right? So stimuli are always chaotic, and only after passing through the frame and being able to be formulated as a coherent story, we can discern those stimuli as an event, right? So counterintuitively, even though the event happens first and then passes through a perception window, passes through a sense-making window, and is narrated as a coherent story mapped to some sort of model of reality, in practice, what happens is that the event in and of itself appears as something discernible only after it has passed through the through our perception and sense-making window. And we will unpack this further. And if you're following so far, you should be able to understand how the frame, the sense-making window, is such a strategically important place, an element of the process of perception. Because it controls the story level, how we the kind of stories, the kind of narratives, the kind of coherent imaginaries about reality we tell ourselves, and we operate and act according to, right? Hence, a lot happens at this stage, and it's of strategic importance for our purposes in order to understand how perception is acting, and how it can be modulated and is continuously being modulated. All right, so let's zoom in now on the frame stage. And the key thing here is that this frame stage, the frame, the sense-making window, is reliant on previous experiences and knowledge stored in memory. Right, so we're interpreting external stimuli continuously. This process doesn't stop. And in those interpretations are happening in that frame stage, right? So the frame stage itself is built, so it uses as its building blocks knowledge and experiences and patterns stored in memory, right? This is what it operates with. These are these are the tools that our sense-making window uses in order to process and interpret external stimuli. Right, so we have experiences and knowledge stored in memory, and these experiences and knowledge stored in memory is what we call schema. Right, so this is a very important thing to differentiate. So we have schema, and then we have frames. Right, so schema are the constituent blocks of frames. They are what frames are made from. Previous experiences and knowledge stored in memory. And the notion of schema itself was first isolated and conceptualized by two very, very famous researchers. So Jean Piaget in 1923 wrote a fantastic book called The Language and Thought of the Child, in which he described schema for the first time. So he observed the way children learn, and he specifically focused on the fact that when children are given an explanatory pattern about external reality, such as an animal being pointed at as and identified to the child as a dog, And the child identifies from now on that this animal with four legs is a dog. And then the child identifying another animal, a cow in this case, also as a dog without knowing that this is a cow. And the question is, why is the child identifying the cow as a dog? And the answer is because it already has a stored pattern in memory of an animal with four legs being a dog. Hence, the important lesson here that Piaget isolated is that this is how children actually learn and process the external environment, by the creation of schema. And this applies to all of us. And the other thinker here is Frederick Bartlett, who in 1932, so 9 years later after Piaget, wrote a book called Remembering, a Study in Experimental and Social Psychology, in which he was interviewing a number of different people about a story he had told them earlier. And each person told the story in a different way, and this is a phenomenon familiar to pretty much all of us. Whether that be a joke or any other story, everyone will tell it slightly differently. But the key thing here is that each person told the story in a different way and according to their past experiences, right? So that pattern, informational pattern, that being the story that all of these different people were being told, was retold by them in association with previous experience and information patterns stored in memory. And he made the argument that this is again an example of Piaget's schema. The important thing here though is that schema have a very important evolutionary role. So these are schema phenomena with their origin in human evolution. And they have a fundamental role because they allow us to act very quickly in a complex and changing environment, right? We do not have to process all stimuli, all information that we see from the beginning to the end, from end to Z, if we can identify something as something that we have already seen before. Right? This is a fundamental importance. So we encounter something, we encounter an information pattern, we store it in memory because of the way we encountered it and the way we acted, maybe, right? So this literally means you can imagine a situation where primitive hominids are in a forest somewhere and encountering a fruit for the first time and tasting it, and the fruit tastes good. So this experience straight away goes into schema, and every time they see that fruit again, they already can operate according to this shortcut that these fruits taste good. Similarly with danger, right? So if you see something in a complex environment, such as a forest or a jungle or a savanna or whatever, if you notice a predator, right, in that moving in a specific pattern or displaying some sort of information, easily identifiable information pattern, this straight away goes into memory, becomes schema, which allows speed of reaction the next time you see some this specific predator, right? So the schema has a fundamental evolutionary importance for humans as a species. So what is schema again? Starting in early childhood, basically from birth, we store external stimuli in memory as patterns of experiences. Keyword patterns, right? So these are linked together. And over time, as we encounter these similar patterns again and again, right? Here the repetition is very important, and we'll talk more about this down the track. These repeating patterns stabilize in memory as association change. So we start to associate this specific pattern that we've noticed with other things, building associative chains between different patterns, right? Which allows us to speed up our reaction in a very complex environment. This allows us to build very complex behavioral traits based on stimuli coming from external environment. And it is this association chains built from different patterns that we've matched in memory that form schema. So to explain it in other words, this is more or less like this. You have a pattern which, you know, again borrowing from internet terminology, which looks more or less like this: if this, then that, right? So if this happens, then that should all should happen, or if this happens, then I should react in this way, or if this happens, then I can expect to feel that, right? So these are patterns, right? And they can be extremely simple when you break them down into their constituent parts. The thing is that they stabilize in memory as association chains that we build very complex edifices from, right? That in turn form frames. Okay, so we have schema. Now, let's analyze this even further. So we have, and go through examples. We have this notion of external stimulus stored in memory as patterns. And the classic example here is you have a fire and the child wanting to touch the fire because it's a fascinating moving thing made of light. Of course, you want to touch it. And then the child touches the fire, burns its hand. And here, automatically, we have a pattern. We have an associative chain being built, right? The fire burns. The fire is hot and you shouldn't touch it, right? This is the simplest possible base level example of external stimuli stored in memory as a pattern. However, we have over time the appearance of repeating patterns. So over time, these repeating patterns stabilize in memory association chains. So again, that child grows up or continues growing, and then experience if the child lives in Western culture and in the Northern Hemisphere specifically, chances are the child would have some sort of experience with celebrating Yule or Christmas or whatever you want to call the winter solstice celebrations. And then you have all sorts of different associative patterns being added to that basic schema of to that basic pattern of if you touch the fire, you burn yourself. So you have other associations such as being next to the fire and experiencing warmth, having that pleasant Christmas atmosphere, you know, having presents, Christmas trees, etc., etc., right? The socks hanging from the fireplace, etc. And then, you know, you over time, these patterns stabilize with all sorts of other associative chains as well. So, you know, you have the fireplace and Christmas, but then you have the camping fire, right? And the sausages over the camping fire and the experience, the family experience of being out camping. So this is another associative chain that is being added here, right? Associated with fire. And again, this continues. And you know, in adulthood, chances are if you're looking at this kind of image, you straight away can identify it with opulence because of the presence of the fireplace in this kind of architecture and in this kind of environment, this kind of room. There's all sorts of different patterns here which you automatically map to existing schema, to existing associative chains. And so the example I'm giving is the way over time, through repetition, these patterns, these information patterns that have the element of the fire in them, stabilize in memory as complex associative chains. And it is this associative chains that we term as schema. And the process is something that happens continuously, right? It doesn't stop happening when we grow up, right? So this is something that happens continuously because every time we encounter external stimuli of any sort, we continuously map them to our existing schema. So this is this process of the sense-making window that I already described. So we continuously map external stimuli to existing schema, and this existing schema itself can be continuously updated through interactions with external stimuli, right? So just in the same way that one learned that fire burns, then through additional experiences, through additional encounters with external stimuli, one learns that fire also warms and fire is also associated with Christmas, etc., etc. So we have existing schema being changed, being altered, being modulated by altering the association chains that form existing schema. And you can alter those association chains either by addition or by the rewiring of the associative links themselves. And we'll talk more about this down the track. So the perceptual frame itself, right, the sense-making window, is built out of this schema. And here is an example of how this kind of modulation and altering can work. So, looking at this image, chances are just that you would straight away identify that phenomenon on the firewall as a fireplace giving warmth. Well, the thing is that this is not a real fireplace. This is just a gas heater which is made to look like a fireplace. The question is why? And the answer is because that way it maps to existing schema in our minds, right? It could be made to look like something else entirely, right? There's no reason why it should be made to look like classical typical fireplace. The reason is in order to map to our existing schema of a place, of a fireplace, and therefore make use of all the associative chains that come with it. And this is a really important lesson, because by knowing what the associative chains associated with a specific phenomenon are in an audience's mind, one knows how to position something new for that specific audience. One knows how to reweave those associative chains by positioning new phenomena for that audience. And we'll again talk more about this down the track. Another example here, you can continuously reweave existing association chains simply by using those existing associative chains in new contexts or adding new elements to them. Especially repetition here plays especially a good role. You can completely reweave someone's association with any phenomenon by a continuous repetition of different association. Or you could subtly alter it by injecting new associative chains with it. And the reason that this works is that our perceptual frame is built out of schema, so we perceive reality using the schema already set in memory. Right? So in that sense, our sense-making apparatus is wide open to the outside. It has to be in order for us to be able to make sense of what we perceive. But that is its greatest weakness as well, because by the careful construction of specific information stimuli, one can, in principle and in practice, as we will see down the track in this lecture, can modulate existing schema and rewire associative chains within the schema, right? So let's do some more thinking now about what all of this means. So starting in early childhood, we start gathering external stimuli in memory as patterns of experiences. Our mind starts organizing them according to patterns and linking them together in terms of stable association chains. Stable because they reside in memory and they act out as kind of ready-made if this then that statements, right? So if it's fire, then it's hot in this sense. And it is these stable association chains that we call schema. And schema operate as multiple blocks providing a filter. This is the frame of perception, the sense-making window, that allow us to process external stimuli by mapping them to the existing schema. And this is also the moment where existing schema can be changed simply by altering the association chain. So whenever existing schema is continuously bombarded by a new configuration of association chains, our mind automatically rewires existing schema. And again, this is part of an evolutionary mechanism. Therefore, the perceptual frame the sense making window is built out of schema. So Richard Sawyer, in his book Psychology of Intelligence Analysis, describes this process as follows. A schema is any pattern of relationships among data stored in memory. It is any set of nodes and links between them in the spider web of memory that hang together so strongly that they can be retrieved and used more or less as a single unit. And that's key, because all of these different associative chains that we already mapped, we already described conceptually, act as single units. This gives us as a species tremendous speed in terms of decision making and in terms of reaction in complex environments, right? This is what makes humans so unique. However, this is also a weakness, an exploit, because when manipulated, when modulated, these associative chains keep acting as a single unit, but in a new configuration, right? And we will talk more about this now. So now, the process of framing itself is really interesting, because we deploy this assemblages of schema continuously in a frame of that our mind uses to perceive reality. And the thing is that this is not an optional activity. This is not something that we choose to do or maybe not to do, right? So this is a fundamental this is the fundamental way in which our mind interacts with the outside world, in which our mind perceives reality. And again, the way Richard Sawyer describes it is people have no conceivable way of coping with the volume of stimuli that impinge upon their senses, or with the volume and complexity of the data they have to analyze, without some kind of simplifying preconceptions about what to expect, what is important, and what is related to what. And it is these simplifying preconceptions, actually, that are generated by schema, by all the different schema that creates a frame of perception. So what to expect, what is important, and what is related to what. So frames are built out of schema, and they're used to create these simplifying preconceptions about what to expect about this, the external world that is continuously bombarding our senses, what is important, what is less important, what should we focus on, our perception and our mind, and what is related to what are the internal linkages between the phenomena that we are perceiving. So these are the three fundamental elements of this sense-making window that we just described in the context of frames built by schema. And Robert Entman, in his Framing Towards Clarification of a Fractured Paradigm, identifies two crucial elements to the process of framing. This is the process of deploying a frame to perceive reality, or the process of creation, the creation of frames for others to perceive and engage with. Because remember, we talked about the ability to manipulate and to alter how others see reality by the creation of specific associative chains which engage with schema already in an audience's mind. So what Entman is describing here is the creation of these frames populated by different associative chains. And the two key maneuvers in the process of framing, in the process of frame creation, are selection and salience. So the way he frames it is, framing essentially involves selection and salience. To frame is to select some aspects of a perceived reality and make them more salient in a communicating text in such a way as to promote a particular problem definition, causal interpretation, moral evaluation, and or treatment recommendation for the item described. So it is to select some aspects of a perceived reality and make them more salient in a communicating text, right? So we have two key maneuvers. You're selecting an element, you're selecting some sort of pattern, maybe some sort of associative chain, and you're making it more prominent. You're making it stand out. You're making it more salient within that frame that is being built. And salience is interesting here, because it involves the creation of perspective, as it were. So you have to make that something that is being made salient stand out. In Entman's words, It involves making a piece of information more noticeable, meaningful, or memorable to audiences. An increase in salience enhances the probability that receivers will perceive the information, discern meaning, and thus process it and store it in memory, right? So again, to retrace our steps, we have the ability to create specific information frames, right, which we communicate to an audience. The audience perceives reality through their own perceptual frames. And what Antman is describing here is the process of identifying a pattern within the frame we have created, or a pattern that we want to inject in that frame that we're making, and making that pattern stand out and become noticeable, meaningful, or memorable to audiences in such a way that audiences can link to that pattern through their own associative chain. So they can recognize some sort of relationship between their own schema and the schema that we have presented in the frame that we are making. So this has a reverse side as well, though. So when faced with a frame that someone has made for our consumption, we have to presume that something has been made salient, something has been selected to stand out for our consumption. So the reverse part of this process, literally this is a metaphorical retracing of steps, is to observe and analyze when faced with the information frame, and this is basically any piece of content is an information frame, any media is an information frame, any environment for that matter is an information frame first and foremost, because that's how our minds perceive it, right? We already established that. So by observing and analyzing what has been made salient, what has been made to stand out, to be noticeable, to be memorable, what has been positioned in such a way so that we can create associative chains with it, or we can it can be strong enough and memorable enough to rewire our associative chains. By observing and analyzing that, we can deduce the algorithm of selection, right? Because remember, if a piece of media is being created, or an environment is being generated for use, or content is being made for our consumption, there is always an algorithm of selection. Something has been selected to be made salient, and something else has been selected to be in the background, right? Because again, remember, these are information frames, right? They are populated by what acts as schema, right? Otherwise, if there was no discernible schema in that specific frame that was created for our purposes, we wouldn't literally be able to perceive it, or we will perceive it in a completely different way according to some algorithm generated by our own schema. So the key thing here is that one can deduce the algorithm of selection. So one can deduce what the intentions of the party making the frame were in picking that specific phenomenon, that specific pattern to stand out, as opposed to some other phenomenal pattern to stand out and to be salient in the frame. Okay, so let's reassess where we are so far. Framing is our sense-making window, is a central organizing idea or storyline that simplifies the volume and complexity of information stimuli by classifying that perceived reality through selection and salience and providing meaning. And this process works both internally in the sense of how we make meaning of the external stimuli hitting our perception window, and also externally in the sense of how we make media, how we make content, how we generate and construct information or any environment. Because again, remember, every and all environments or phenomena are perceived by the mind as information phenomena. So again, the process of framing is a process of providing meaning through selection and salience. and we perceive reality through a frame, right? And what we perceive, especially in information, dense information rich realities, such as modern reality in a post-industrial information-based society, these are realities almost entirely constructed by ready-made, pre-constructed frames, right? So ready-made frames constructed specifically for consumption, as opposed to the wild, completely chaotic environment that is presented, let's say, by a jungle setting or forest setting or tundra setting, right? So this is, here is a very interesting contrast between nature in its wild complexity, unstructured complexity, and urbanized environment, which is always already structured, always already framed, always already constructed for consumption by someone perceiving it. So the other thing about frames is that they can be made from any phenomena. So you can use any elements of reality to construct a frame. This can be objects, they can be feelings, they can be other entities, living beings, or any other phenomena, because again, remember, perception operates on the basis of information, right? So any and all stimuli hitting a perception window are interpreted as information stimuli. So when making a frame, any and all entities or objects or feelings or ideas can be used to construct the frame and to construct associative chains. So, because of the way our mind evolved to operate, and our perception apparatus evolved to engage with reality, when we encounter new phenomena, any new phenomena for that matter, we have to build a new frame for understanding them and for mapping them to already existing schema in our mind. And we can only do that with the bits and pieces of schema already stored in memory, right? Because our minds have nothing else to work with, literally. Our minds can only work with what is already in memory. And this is really important to understand, because any new phenomena, any new reality hitting a perception window is automatically categorized and classified according to the bits and pieces of a schema already in memory. And what this means is that that new reality, that new frame that has hit our perception window is automatically already interfacing with the schema, the bits and pieces of schema stored in memory. And if you truly understand what this means, you should understand that this is as much a strength as it is a weakness, because it's something that can be exploited. And as Richard Sawyer describes this, the key factor in transferring information from short-term to long-term memory, and short-term memory is literally that memory which holds all the stimuli that we have just perceived. So this is our perception window. So the key factor in transferring information from the short term to the long term is the development of associations between the new information and schema already available in memory, right? So they interface together, and they invariably have to, in order to for us to remember whatever it is that we encountered, we have to somehow link it through associative chains with schema already in memory. And as a corollary, right, so what follows is that any new information we have encountered is automatically assimilated to and interpreted by schema already existing in memory. So what this means is, from the perspective of someone who is making frames, someone who is building information for others to consume, is that in order to build a successful frame, a persuasive frame, let's call it that way, we have to use the elements from schema already existing in the minds of our users. Hence why it's so important to understand one's users or the audience one is targeting with a specific frame, because we need to, in order for our frame to be successful in persuading that audience, we need to know what are the schema, what are the associative chains already existing in that audience's mind. Why do we need to know that? Because we need to, in order for us to be successful in our selection and salience, right? So in order for us to be able to successfully select appropriate associative chains, appropriate schema for our frame, and in order for us to arrange them in a way which is persuasive, in a way which connects with the schema already in the audience's mind. So again, selection and salience. Hence, again, why it's so important to understand an audience's schema, to understand how they perceive reality, to understand what the associative chains are in that audience's perception frame. So you can use it, look at this process from both ways, from the perspective of someone perceiving reality, from internal perspective, where this is a matter of analyzing the frames that are hitting our perception and trying to understand what is the algorithm used for selection and salience, right? So what is this frame intended to persuade us to do, in other terms? And then you can look at this process from an external perspective, from a perspective of someone making frames to be consumed by others, where the key question is not what is the algorithm, but what should the algorithm be in order to generate a message through selection and salience successful enough to connect with that specific audience's internal associative chains. And I will, based on everything I've discussed so far, I will analyze an example, and this is a classic example from the history of public relations and from the history of propaganda, and it comes from the person who invented propaganda and public relations. In his mind, this is Edward Bernays. In his mind, propaganda and public relations were the same thing. In fact, he first invented the term propaganda, and he wrote a great book on the topic. And then when propaganda started being associated in a negative light after the Second World War, after the experiences we had with dictatorships using propaganda against their populations, then he changed the term to public relations. So he reframed the term to another term in order to avoid those negative associative chains. And the case study that I want to focus on is famous or infamous, depending how you look at it, Torches of Freedom campaign. So this was an advertising campaign that Bernays was hired to do by the American Tobacco Corporation, which at that time was a monopolist, creating tobacco products exclusively for men. And in 1929, so this is almost 10 years, so 10 years after the First World War, he was hired by the American Tobacco Corporation to position smoking and cigarettes for women. And at that time, the starting frame he had to work from, it was taboo for women to smoke. So women would not be buying cigarettes. So literally 50% or slightly more than 50% of the population was not smoking, was not engaging with cigarettes as a commodity, because there was a cultural taboo on women to smoke, in public or in private for that matter. Another aspect of that starting frame, so at that time, the suffragette movement, demanding voting rights for women and emancipation and equality, you could view it as the first wave of feminism, was in its heyday. So there were regular suffragette marches through the big cities in the United States and other Western countries. And the task that was posed to Barnet was to persuade women to start smoking in this environment, right? So this sets the stage, the starting frame, as it were. And it's really interesting to analyze what is it that Barnes did to persuade women to smoke. And his campaign is studied across the world as a brilliant example of public relations and advertising and propaganda, for that matter, right? Again, in Bernays's mind, public relations, advertising, and propaganda were the same thing, literally, just three different terms for the same process. And the reason for that was that fundamentally, the process we're describing here is the process of creating a persuasive frame through the manipulation of associative chains, fundamentally through the selection and salience. Right, through selecting specific schema, positioning them in a frame, selecting specific associative chains, positioning them in a frame, which then is used to connect to schema in the audience's mind and remold, reweave, reconnect those associative chains in the audience's mind in a new configuration. So what Barnes did is very interesting. He hired a group of young female models to march with a suffragette parade. So there was a parade in New York in 1929. I forgot already what specific occasion was the parade for. There was supposed to be also a suffragette march at that parade. And so he hired a group of young women to march in that parade and in the suffragette march as well, and to, at a signal given by him, take out cigarettes and start smoking ostentatiously. And he also collected the representatives from the press and told them that there will be something special happening on that day at that march, and he asked them all to be there with him. And so when this happened, the march started and the young women he had hired marched by him, he gave them the signal, they started smoking, the photographers all started making pictures, and a specific associative chain was automatically created. And there were hundreds of articles appearing across the newspapers in the United States discussing the occasion in all sorts of different terms, but the key thing from Barnes' perspective is that a specific associative chain had been formed, and that was the association between women and emancipation. Hence, you know, we have the suffragette march, and then we have this sign of the act of rebellion, that call for equality that is associated with the suffragette movement. We had the cigarette element, and we had all of this appearing together in one frame. And then on top of that, in a stroke of brilliance, Barnet started running ads across a number of different newspapers in which he called cigarettes torches of freedom. This was following that specific public relations standard that he generated. And these cigarettes were positioned as torches of freedom, not accidentally. They were torches because the Statue of Freedom is holding a torch, right? Hence, cigarettes were torches of freedom, again, using the Statue of Liberty association. As you know, Statue of Liberty is also a woman, together with the associative chain brought in by the suffragette movement, the first wave of feminism demands for equality and voting rights and emancipation. And so we have the appearance of a completely new frame built from very powerful associative chains plus cigarettes, right? So he brought together a lot of different associative chains. This, the call for equality, the call for freedom and emancipation, the call for voting rights coming with the suffragette, the Statue of Liberty, right? One of the key archetypal symbols of the United States, and cigarettes, plus cigarettes. So the idea was that by creating this frame and continuously broadcasting it at women, you are in effect reweaving the associative chain around cigarettes in the schema of the female population, right? Because suddenly cigarettes are not seen as a cultural taboo, as something negative to be avoided, but as a completely different sign, as a sign of emancipation, equality, freedom, and a statement of one's value, as it were. So this is an example. So these are early images from those times, an example of how this was positioned, right? So we have women walking together and smoking in public. And the ads from that time are really interesting because you can see how they're riding that specific associative chain, that specific frame that Bernays had created, right? Believe in yourself. Smoking became a symbol of female emancipation and equality with men through the deployment of the frame that Bernays had generated. And again, he generated it out of a multiplicity of different associative chains, each of which was carefully chosen and positioned in order to create that very strong positioning, so again, selection and salience, for cigarettes, right? As the key object which allows emancipation, the key object which signifies freedom, the key object which demonstrates equality with men, right? So the act of holding a cigarette itself, right? And again, this was his intention by asking the photographers and asking the young women to open and light up the cigarettes at that specific moment. The act of holding the cigarette itself became a symbol of emancipation and equality. Not even the act of smoking as such, but the holding of the lit cigarette. And you can see this in pictures from the time, right? So it is an object of associated with emancipation, with female emancipation, when held by women. And to really appreciate what is happening here is, again, you have to remember the starting frame, right? Just a year before, female smoking was a cultural taboo, right? And what Bernays did was to reweave those associative chains in people's minds, in women's minds. Here you have an example of a later ad from the early 30s from a Lucky Strike, and you can see how the frame slightly evolves here, catering to the taste of women, because tobacco used to be quite hard for women's throats, and it wasn't pleasant at all in terms of the pure experience. So they started creating specific tobacco brands for women. And at the same time, they were still using the same associative chains that Bernays had generated. So an ancient prejudice has been removed, right? So you have literally the shattering of chains, right? The chain is being shattered. Emancipation, freedom, liberation, right? So this is the main element of the original frame is preserved while the frame itself evolves, because it's not so much about the act of smoking, but about the specific brand now, right? So that once that breach has been made and cigarettes are not taboo anymore, right, following the success of the original campaign by Bernays, now companies start positioning specific brands, associating specific brands with that original frame, with that original associative chain of liberation. So an ancient prejudice has been removed. What is that prejudice? The prejudice against women smoking, that taboo. Here is another example of a variation of the same ad. You have the oppressive patriarchal masculine on the left, and we have then the shattering of chains, and then we have the liberated young woman who is liberated through the act of smoking. Right, it's the act of holding the cigarette that is positioned as the act of emancipation here. Right, so again, notice what is happening is a reweaving of associative chains through the act of frame. And here you have an even later example. Amelia Earhart was the first female aviator to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean. And look at the way this is positioned. Lucky Strike were the cigarettes carried on the friendship when she crossed the Atlantic. So it's a the act of carrying this specific brand or using this specific brand automatically signifies achievement and emancipation and equality with men. Again, so just to sum up, we have the creation of a new frame by the addition of a variety of associative chains, carefully selected in order to make cigarettes stand out, become salient, and associated with this specific schema: equality, freedom, feminism, Statue of Liberty. A key thing that has to be understood, however, is that for this to work, the schema had to already independently, so not in a new frame obviously, but independently, they had to already exist in the audience's mind. So this campaign could have been successful only in an environment where women already knew about equality and the movement for female liberation. They already knew about the Statue of Liberty, right, and what the torch of freedom means. They already knew about the suffragettes and the movement for voting rights, etc., etc., right? So this schema had to already independently exist in the audience's minds for Barnes's maneuver to be successful, because otherwise they wouldn't be able to map this new frame that he created to anything already in memory. All right, so to finish off, we have the act of perception of reality happening through frames, and frames in turn being built from schema, which are stored in our minds, they're stored in memory. Schema being patterns and relationships and associative chains. We build frames by selecting some aspects of reality. So we select specific associative chains and making them more salient. We make them stand out, right? We weave them into a specific pattern. And finally, by observing and analyzing what has been made salient for our consumption in a given frame, you can deduce the algorithm of selection. You can deduce the intentions of the frame maker. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter at Ted Mitiu. Thank you all for listening, and see you online.